There's an old mantra that says predicting the future is easy. Predicting the future accurately is much more difficult. And there are plenty of mildly amusing historical examples where that wisdom has been demonstrated. Fast forward to 2023, and one of the popular future predictions doing the rounds on social media at the moment is that the world will not be able to move away from fossil fuels in the 21st century using currently available alternative technologies, because there simply aren't enough minerals and other raw materials on the planet to scale those technologies up. So maybe we should have a think about that, eh? Hello, and welcome to Just Have a Think. If someone wanted to get an idea of the quantity of raw materials and amount of infrastructure required to transition away from fossil fuels and run an alternative energy system instead, it'd be logical to start by assessing how much energy the current system produces and then calculate how much of the alternative technology you'd need in order to provide that same amount of energy. It'd also be important to calculate how much the world's energy demand is likely to increase in the coming decades, not only through population growth, but also as a result of higher wealth, especially in the rapidly growing developing nations. One of the difficulties in making that assessment is the fact that industry experts don't all agree about how to compare the energy going into the front of any given system against the usable energy coming out at the other end. You may recognise this as EROI, or Energy Return on Investment, or possibly EROEI, which stands for Energy Returned on Energy Invested. This recent article by industry expert Michael Barnard explains a common misperception about something called primary energy. The primary energy fallacy, he explains, is the assumption that all of the energy in all of the oil, gas and coal that we burn today must be replaced. We don't need to replace it, he argues, we need to replace the unwasted energy services. To illustrate what he means by that, Michael steers us towards this rather daunting graphic. It's an example of something called a Sankey chart. This one was produced by the Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory to represent the United States energy system in 2021. On the left are all the different energy technologies currently in use in the US and the amount of energy each of them produced in that year, measured in quads, or quadrillion British thermal units. One quad is roughly equivalent to the energy content of 170 million barrels of crude oil, 36 million metric tons of coal, or 970 billion cubic feet of natural gas. The section in the middle, that looks a bit like the London Underground map, shows how the various energy types get shunted around the system. What's important though is what gets spat out at the end. Only about a third of the primary energy from the left-hand side actually arrives as usable final energy on the right-hand side. The other two-thirds are waste or rejected energy. And where is most of that waste energy produced? Well, according to this chart, it's pretty much all coming from coal, oil and gas. But if you based your calculations on the left-hand side of this chart, as some analysts do, then you might still reach the conclusion that fossil fuels are a clear winner. But what about that intermittency thing I mentioned earlier? There are analysts who argue that most countries, certainly up here in the Northern Hemisphere, would need a good month's worth of non-stop energy storage to get them over their dark and cold winters, and that the sheer quantity of raw materials required to achieve that would be tens or in some cases even hundreds of times more than the total amount available on the planet. So clearly not a viable option then, right? Again though, it's not difficult to find research literature that comes to very different conclusions. Analysis by an energy industry consultancy called RethinkX, which we looked at in this video back in 2021, shows how the precipitous drop in the price of wind and solar power will enable their future generating capacity to greatly exceed the total electricity generating capacity installed today. That overbuild will result in systems that are large enough to get us through the dark and miserable months of Northern Hemisphere winters. And then, during the other 9 months of the year, those wind turbines and solar panels will be massively overproducing energy at very close to zero marginal cost. Instead of switching them off, which is what we do now in a process called curtailment, that zero marginal cost energy will be used to replace a whole bunch of currently very carbon intensive stuff like water desalination, road transportation, residential and commercial heating and cooling, waste management, and industrial and chemical processes, all of which will further reduce our reliance on fossil fuels and massively lower the requirement for those scarce materials. And by the way, batteries aren't the only method of storing energy. About 99% of all utility-scale energy storage by volume today is in the form of pumped hydro. There's a popular perception that we've used up pretty much every geographically and topologically appropriate global location for pumped hydro, which essentially requires a large water reservoir at the top and bottom of a hill, and also needs to be sited well away from rivers so that it doesn't screw up riverine ecosystems in the way that hydroelectric dams sometimes do. But two recent papers appear to debunk that notion as well. This one, published in 2021 by the Australian National University, found no fewer than 616,000 off-river sites all over the world with a combined energy potential of 23 million gigawatt hours, which they say is about 100 times what would be needed to support a 100% global renewable electricity system. Over in the US, the National Renewable Energy Laboratory, or NREL, found nearly 15,000 potentially viable new pumped hydro sites in the US alone, representing 35,000 gigawatt hours of energy storage. And again, links to those papers are in the description section below this video. Ah yes, I hear you cry, but we can't ignore the impending tsunami of electric vehicles that we're all hearing so much about in the news these days, can we? They all need batteries, don't they? So what about all those raw materials like lithium, nickel, cobalt, manganese and copper, for example? Well, for starters, as we've discovered in previous videos on this channel, the world's largest battery manufacturers have already moved across to lithium iron phosphate chemistries for many of today's electric vehicles. Those batteries contain no nickel or cobalt at all. To get a bit more of a steer on this, I spoke to electrochemistry expert and energy industry consultant Ewan McTurk via Zoom recently.
Obviously, the advent of lithium iron phosphate means that we're moving away from nickel for a large swathe of, or will move away from nickel for a large swathe of electric vehicles, including already some of the best-selling makes and models on the market, because lithium's not really, it's not rare at all. There's something like 80 million tons of lithium on land, probably more. We keep finding more all the time, but also 230 billion tons of lithium in seawater, not deep sea mining, just in seawater. And there's probably about enough lithium in the hard rock at Cornish Lithium's Cornish mine for 5 million electric vehicles. So, you know, as I say, there's so much lithium, you can extract it ethically. People are starting to extract it ethically. You can recycle it.
Lithium's not the only game in town either. There are already production passenger vehicles on sale in China that use sodium ion battery chemistry, which eliminates the need for lithium altogether.
Sodium, obviously, there's just such vast supply chains for that. So there's more reserves, but there's also more production capacity. There are knock-on advantages to the chemistry of sodium ion. The fact that you can reversibly discharge it to 0 volts, in other words, stick a resistor across the terminals, ship it halfway around the world, and then recharge it and use it safely, which you cannot do with lithium ion. That means you're shipping cells with no energy in them, which means not only are they safer to ship, but they are cheaper to ship. So yeah, big difference. And that's why you'll probably see sodium ion battery packs at a cost of about $50 per kilowatt hour. Also the sodium ion setup, the fact that you don't necessarily have to have cobalt in a sodium ion cell. You also don't need to have copper in a sodium ion cell because you can replace the current collector on the negative electrode with aluminium, which keeps the cost down and the weight down. Such as the progress that we're making with these different chemistries, the diversification of chemistries, it is rampant.
And on top of all that, electric vehicles are increasingly being equipped with bi-directional batteries, which means they can feed electrons into your home's electrical system and even back into the national grid. This paper, published in January 2023, used what the authors describe as conservative calculations to find that a participation rate among EV owners of between 12 and 43%, depending on location, could provide all of the short-term grid storage demand globally, and that if only 50% of EV batteries at end of vehicle life are repurposed into stationary utility-scale energy storage units, EV owner participation rates would only need to be about 10%. They also suggest that short-term grid storage demand could be met as early as 2030 across most regions. There is another point of view altogether though, that sits outside the heated debate about how to fuel our ever-expanding world. Some argue that it's completely delusional to suggest we can continue with our constant global economic growth model simply by replacing fossil fuels with wind turbines, solar panels, energy storage, and a bit of nuclear or whatever. There's a substantial body of opinion that says we have to address the fundamentals of how much each of us consumes, how efficiently we do that consuming, and how much stuff we throw away that could otherwise be put to good use. That's a discussion in its own right, and it's one that's been rumbling on since at least 1972 when the seminal book Limits to Growth was published by the Club of Rome. But does that mean we shouldn't try to move away from fossil fuels at all, though, and that the whole green transition thing is just a pointless exercise? Well, here's just one statistic that suggests it most certainly is not. According to the World Health Organization, 99% of the entire human population breathes air that exceeds WHO guideline limits, and 7 million people, many of them children, die prematurely every single year as a direct result of air pollution caused by the combustion of fossil fuels. So even if nothing else got worse, even if we didn't see more famine and disease caused by drought and floods, even if we didn't see more climate migration away from increasingly uninhabitable regions, and even if we didn't see more regional conflicts in the fight over dwindling food and water resources, even if none of those things happened, just the air pollution alone from our current level of fossil fuel combustion would result in over 500 million unnecessarily early deaths between now and the end of this century. That's it for this week. Thanks as always to our amazing Patreon supporters who keep me going and enable me to keep ads and sponsorship messages out of all my videos. And I must just give a quick shout out to some folks who've joined recently with pledges of $10 or more a month. They are Daniel Elazar, Todd Spencer, Roger Cuthbert, Donald Vig, Sean Smith, Mark, and Thomas Kagi. And of course, a massive thank you to everyone else who's joined since last time too. If you feel you could support my work on the Just Have a Think channel and you'd like the chance to influence future content, then you can get involved with that by visiting patreon.com/justhaveathink, where you'll get early access to all my videos, plus exclusive additional monthly content from me. And if you feel I've earned your support here on YouTube, then you can demonstrate that absolutely for free by subscribing and hitting that like button. Dead easy to do that. You just need to click down there or on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.